since 1999, started XP. I've seen hundreds of organizations in these 20 years. I just was in Valerie's talk, talking about native agile teams. I'm an agile native. I've never written code to a specification. I've never been in a project where we had a Gantt chart deadlines oriented plan. And I haven't committed code into production regularly in this century. So that's, I'm not a developer anymore, but I used to be. And what I do now is I'm a trust artist. I increase trust in individuals and systems. I'm also a certified enterprise coach with the Scrum Alliance that comes with this beautiful silver badge. Really quite proud of. It was hard to get, and it's a nice community to be part of. Otherwise, I'm probably the least dramatic person you find with the Scrum Alliance affiliation. I'd be the first person to recommend you stop doing Scrum if that hurts, or if you find something more useful to do. What I strongly believe is that we deserve to love what we do, and that when we do, when we find something to work on that we love, or when we get the chance to change the way we work and what we work on so that we love it, then it becomes bigger, it becomes more purposeful, it becomes healthier, and it creates great outcomes. And I want to increase people's chances of experiencing that. That's kind of my mission as a coach. I would like you to briefly check in with yourself and just think how you are. This is a very introvert kind of check-in. I'm not going to ask you to tell me, but just use this as a moment to think, how do I feel at this afternoon after all of this inspiration, all of this conversation? Probably a little tired, like I am, but being here, getting all this attention, gets my adrenaline kicked, so I do feel awake right now. But I give you a chance, by stopping to talk, to just check in with yourself and realize how you feel and become a little more present. I find this very helpful, and it's one of the leadership techniques that I teach, that whenever we change the context, we try to actually arrive consciously, instead of running from meeting to meeting, running from conversation to conversation, from context to context, always carrying some emotional baggage, still thinking about that problem, why we should be listening to that person, etc., etc. So being more in the now as a leader is a very important thing that I have learned in many, many hard ways. One of the leadership things I do is I run certified agile leadership trainings. The certified is the least important stuff. Agile leadership to me is very different from what agile leadership is for other people. Many people think that agile leadership is a very special way of leadership, in contrast to non-agile leadership. I don't know what non-agile leadership is. What I know is that agility is something that regularly improves. So agile leadership is a journey rather than a position. It's a movement, it's a becoming aware of how I lead and improving that. I also provide online coaching courses, stuff like that. If you're interested in that, just look me up. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, something that you might have heard, or that you experienced yourself. Most things that go wrong don't go wrong because somebody wanted to be evil, but because their intentions and the way they went about achieving those intentions didn't really go well with the context and the situations with other people's intentions. And this is a talk about failing and learning. And it will give you a method that you can look at, that you can use to look at your own life, your own situations, your own current situation maybe, and learn from that and become a little more conscious, similar to what I'm talking about. Do you know what improving with intention is?
Well, actually aiming for it.
aiming for it. It's my simplest possible definition of agile. And making a difference with intention is my definition of leadership. So agile leadership, as I said before, it's not a special kind of leadership, it's improving, making a difference with intention. This can be read two ways, that's intentional. It could be improving the difference or improving the making, like how you're making the difference and what difference you make. And that's what we want to improve as leaders. Being intentional, standing in reality, having clarity of choice. This is what we need as, I think, as human beings, but also as leaders. Leaders, by the way, to me, that's not a position or a role or something that only some people do. Everybody of us is leading their life. Many of us might be leading a family, might be leading a team of sorts. Who of you is leading a marriage or a relationship with somebody? Okay. Who is single in this room? Who is not listening? That's okay. That's okay. It's all voluntary. I'm just trying to raise your attention. I know it's late. One really nice definition of leadership, and there are so many ways to define this. Simon Sinek said in a talk that leaders get the perks, like the corner offices, the big cars, big money, bonuses, because we expect that we as tribe members, that's, he says that's ancient human idea built into our genes, so to say, we expect them to go first into unknown and danger. Interesting question for you to ponder upon. When you consider yourself a leader, what kind of unknown, what kind of danger are you leading into? I can give you my answer at the end, if you remember the question. I'm sure there's no slide for this. So, what this talk is about, and what my journey is about, is becoming ever more clear on who I am and what I want. Clarify my identity and my intention. That's the core of being a human being, being successful in anything, and core of leadership in that sense. And the technique I'm going to employ is called clean slate. It's from the method that I use frequently for personal and team development called Temenos. It's the middle part, the part that we use to focus on the present. So when you look at a system, any system, like I could look at this situation now and ask myself, how do I fail currently? How does the system fail me? I'll use this phrase because it rhymes a little bit and it shows the two sides of the coin. And then how does the system serve me and how do I serve the system? So two flip sides, two dimensions, so to say, and questions. I'll give you an example in a minute. Another way to phrase this very simply, somebody did that in a course recently and I really like this. Olaf against the system against Olaf, Olaf for the system for Olaf. This is an easy to remember structure. So I'm preparing for my Riga visit, or Ivo is trying to get me to prepare for a Riga visit. So me against the system against me serving the system serving me. I go into detail. Time is always money. I think I got about three messages on LinkedIn from Ivo, usually one, then another week later, then another day later, like, can you please book your flight, tell me how expensive it was, send me your slides, things like that. So many things I had to do, difficulty to focus. On the other side, as I said, long list of tasks, lots of people wanting stuff from me, that was the system working against me. And then me for the system, yes, I'm helping so many people, I'm putting my attention to so many things. That's a helpful thing, I think. And I'm also interested in so many things. So many things are interesting to me, but also I'm not really happy with it. And on the other hand, the system is providing me with lots of great ideas, lots of stuff to do, people are actually paying me money for my attention, that's nice. People like me, and there's good stuff I'm doing. So this is just very, very brief so that you get a sense of how does this method work, because I've been looking through my journey from a developer to the person standing in front of you now with this lens. So there'll be multiple drawings like this. What you could do, and now I'm getting confused with the order of my slides, that's not intentional. If you grab one of these pieces of paper, and if you want to get more out of this talk, you could create a shape like this on a piece of paper and just jot down notes whenever you think, oh, I'm just getting an interesting idea. That could be an interesting idea because something similar to what I tell you has happened to you or is happening to you. And it could also be that you felt similar in some way, you're feeling similar in some way, and you're just getting a good idea. So you might leave the talk with a few things to look at and with some patterns that you might reflect on afterwards. And this is exactly the purpose of this method. These simple questions guide you to what's interesting in your situation and what you might want to consider. It gives you multiple perspectives because the questions are asked in this way, that they complement each other. They reveal the motivational forces that pull us forward or hold us back. And they separate, and this is the devious part, they separate what we want from what we think others expect. So looking at the to-do list, for instance, right? To-do list consists of stuff that you want to do, and stuff that others want you to do, and stuff that you think you should do, etc., etc. And separating this and getting a sense of, okay, the things that create real value and the things that make me really happy are these, and this is what I want to focus on. The other stuff I want to not do. Does that make sense? And one thing that you notice when I'm sharing this, it's a great exercise to understand how we are all similar and we are all different, which is a crucial learning needed for leaders, but also for everybody who wants to be in a successful team. Because a team gets great when we integrate all of the differences and the similarities is what we need for integration, because they connect us. Have you heard this quote or this song from Leonard Cohen? There's a crack in everything, that's where the light gets in. This clean slate method is a method for identifying the cracks in the system that you find yourself in currently, so you can open them and see what can change and where you can leverage. So, you could take notes, as I said, me against the system against me for the system for me, how do I fail, how does the system fail, how do I serve, how does the system serve. If that pattern is helpful for you, create a shape like that. The questions will be on all the slides, so you don't need to write them down, but if you have a shape like that, you can take notes. So, first chapter, Olaf becoming a programmer. That's, we're talking about something 85 to 95, that kind of area and time. How do I feel the system? I was very, very interested in books. I was a lot more interested in books and reading something, now that I'm saying this, it sounds like reading code, than in working with human beings. I felt mostly excluded from human beings. I felt quite different from everybody else when I was a kid, and that definitely didn't stop until I was 25. Even older. I was also very, very interested in beautiful things, in creative things, more so than other boys were in my environment, and more so than I perceived boys were allowed to at that point in time. I have no recollection of what I wanted to say with this drawing, but maybe it's another pile of books. How does the system feel me? As I said, I was different, and I didn't feel a lot of approval. I felt being frowned upon by a lot of people. For instance, I remember as a small child, I would see relationships. I would go into a room and say something, oh, these two people don't like each other. And my mom would say, shh. She obviously knew why these people didn't like each other, but I didn't. And she didn't want me to say, and she didn't want me to be an object of shaming. Another thing that was I perceived as a failure growing up, not as a small child, but definitely when I went to university, where how shall I earn money? So many different things I'm interested in, no clear path to career, success, anything like that. What I love doing is spending time in front of a computer pretending to be introvert, pretending to be unsocial, and doing lots of beautiful stuff inside that. Because I could absolutely be my creative, my sensitive, my vulnerable self inside the virtual world, which I didn't dare to be in the real world. And I've met hundreds of people who are very similar since. How did the system serve me? I had a really, really lovely family as a child. My brother and I, we grew up in a really caring environment, and I'm really proud to be conscious now that being told by your parents when you're small that no matter what you do, you're loved and whatever you do is okay, that is a really rare gift. The other thing that my parents encouraged me to do was they encouraged me to be different. They never told me to fit in, which is also something that I know now many, many people are told differently. So I'm proud of that. So that's the first overview. What drew me into computers? What drew me into programming? How did I end up being the introvert programmer guy that I was probably somewhere between 17 and 30-ish? And what happened then with 30-ish is I had been promoted to IT lead that was in Hamburg, and we were one of the first three companies in Germany introducing its new programming as a method. And then some political changes in the company led the sponsor, the owner of the company, to kick out the founder and to replace the founder with two youngsters, one of whom was me, as managing directors of the company. We were fastly growing, something from 30 to 80 while I was there. A lot of cash pumped into the company. It was the dot-com period, 2002. Let's look at that. So again, I fail the system. System fails me. I serve the system. System serves me. How do I fail the system? Lots of questions inside, and expecting I need to have the answers. I was 29. I should have said no when they asked me to be the boss, but it didn't even occur to me that I could. If you had asked me, I would probably have said yes, I could not have taken the offer, but it didn't seem a realistic move. What I believed about being a boss was, as a boss you need to know the answers, you need to tell people what to do. I didn't know the answers, and I believed telling people what to do was a stupid idea. So I was absolutely stuck, and I didn't dare to ask for help. I thought that was also something that was not available for bosses. Very stupid idea. So if you ever become a boss, don't believe this, believe other things. What was good, there was the founder who had hired me and who definitely put a lot of trust in me, which on the flip side also was creating this high bar of I need to earn this trust, he trusts me with running this company, I need to make this a success. And there were all of these demands. I perceived there to be so many expectations, so many demands, so many people who wanted my decisions, etc. And that felt really hard, and it created a lot of pain. How do I serve the system? I definitely worked my ass off. I was in the office at 10 in the morning, and I usually stayed somewhere 2 a.m. at night. As a managing director, I need to spend most of my day in meetings, and then I would start programming with my guys and work on the system that we're supposed to deliver. And I did that for several months. Not a healthy thing to do. So another advice that you can take from this, don't overwork yourself for a system, even if it's your own, that this was not my own system. But the system served me. I got a really, really nice and fast car. I got good money. And I got this prospect of climbing the ladder and being a good boy, so to say. Looking back, it was probably this, like, this is what you do, right? You climb up a career ladder. Somebody told me lots of years later that a hamster wheel looks like a career ladder from the inside. I didn't know that at the time, right? So I was following this pattern of what I thought an IT career, software manager, etc. career looks like. Didn't really work that. Not recommended. On the other side, when I look back at this now, it gives me a lot of compassion for managers. I know that behind every asshole in any type of executive position, there's probably somebody who is afraid to be found out, to be too weak for their job. I've met so many people who had a similar way into a software career as I did, in terms of appearing to be fairly unemotional, appearing to avoid social connections, although they like it, but they only dare to have it inside a virtual reality. And all of this is a big, big, big helping thing now, as I'm coaching organizations, as I'm coaching leaders, but it was definitely painful at the time. Zooming forward a few years, after that company broke down, this .com bubble, with the sponsor running off with the money, I became a consultant. And as a consultant, I was quite successful, I was busy, I learned a lot. But at the end of that, we're now talking 2010-ish, I was becoming tired. I didn't learn anything anymore. And I was in a too comfortable position in that company, being the senior consultant. Everybody was like, oh, you can ask Olaf any question, Olaf can solve every problem, etc. Which was nice, obviously, but it wasn't getting me forward. So let's look at this situation. So how do I feel the system? As I said, there was very little that sparked my curiosity. There were not a lot of interesting questions that I had or that would have been answered by the company. My wife and my daughter were not happy with me traveling so much. I was usually away for 3 or 4 days a week, very often in 2 or 3 different cities, visiting sometimes at 1 different time every day. Really, really crazy stuff. Mostly within Germany, so I didn't travel too far, but still. And within this successful box, I was feeling quite alone. I was tired. How did the system fail me? They put me on a pedestal, which in a way sounds nice, but it's also creating a distance. And it removed an important feedback cycle from my system. I didn't notice how bad I felt because everybody adored it so much. And there was a side thing. The payment situation at that moment in that company was really unfair. There was something that I only found out in hindsight. How do I serve the system? I made lots of people happy. I helped organizations, I helped individuals, people in my company were happy because our customers were happy. That was definitely working. And that also created a feedback loop that gave me the sense of success. I was visiting these different places, things grew, things were flourishing, people liked it, I got good feedback, so that was working well. But it didn't fulfill me anymore. At that point in time, I had noticed or got part of the Agile community. I had lost contact with the Agile community between my discovery of XP in the 99-2000 period. Then I think it was a Scrum gathering in Munich in 2009 where I met all of these people and thought, wow, I'm not the only crazy agilist in the world. There are other people who are as crazy as I am. They actually like me and I like them. And so I felt part of the crowd. And I had discovered that there was this thing called Agile coaching. Coaching was not part of my vocabulary before, so I wasn't aware what that was. And I wanted to learn it. So I joined Agile 42, which is an Agile coaching company, and I had a really, really good time there. For instance, I met Sergey there, who's going to have the closing keynote tomorrow. And then, at the end of my period at Agile 42, I got lots of nudges from many people that I should go independent. I also had this strong drive myself that after all of these years of being employed in organizations and fulfilling somebody else's strategy, I had this feeling I need to invent my own thing. I had stopped accepting a system in which I can't learn, in which I get bored, and I wanted to change my work a lot faster than any company would have allowed me to. But had no role models for being independent anywhere. So let's look at this situation. Olaf is scared of being independent. I went independent in 2013, so that's 5 years ago. How do I feel the system? I have so many different things I'm interested in. How do I focus? How do I create a product? How do I create a product that doesn't bore me as soon as I need to deliver it again? I had a long time where I thought I was bad at sales because I would create a course, then I would run it once, then I would run it again with half the people, and then I would not run it again. Looking back to this period 5 years ago, the real reason was that I didn't want to sell it again. I wanted to do something different. So this is obviously Scrum. What is this? How do I fail the system? It's Scrum. I don't know. But what I do remember is that I thought of myself as a much smaller expert than other people thought of me. So whenever people told me like, oh yeah, you could be independent, you will get any job, you will be so successful, I was like, why do you think I should be successful? I'm just this small guy who discovered Agile coaching 2 years ago. Why should that work? How do I deserve this? So I didn't see this path forward. The system didn't offer me any example. I didn't have any independent people in my family. Yes, two of my uncles were doctors, but that was not the kind of independent business thing that I would have needed. I didn't have any money in the bank, so I didn't have anything to be safe with. I needed to earn my money, earn my rent every month as I became independent. And in the system I was in, I felt I was the smallest player in the band. I had joined Agile 42 because I thought I wanted to learn from the best, and I was still perceiving myself as smaller. How do I serve the system? I love what I was doing. Similar to before, I actually created good sustaining change in companies. I was really good as an Agile coach. I couldn't see that yet, but I was. And I also had a system that supported me, like this network within Agile 42, but also the larger network of Agile coaches. I knew so many people, and I still do. I still had so many great ideas, and I could integrate them in this work. So one of the great things about the work we do is that we get to work on all of these people things that are interesting. We also get to work on all of these software things, which are interesting. And we get to work on all of these organizational things that are interesting. So absolutely a job that satisfied my diversity of interests. So, and now, that's kind of the last reflection thing. So we will actually have time for questions, which is good. I'm Olaf, and I'm realizing I'm a leader. Because I remember one thing that was in 2011. There was a movement started by Jürgen Apelo, and then me, and then lots of other people called Agile Lead Europe. Has anybody heard of that? It's been an annual conference ever since. I organized the first one in Berlin in 2011. Within 3 months, we set up a team of 30 or 40 volunteers from about 30 different countries in Europe to set up a conference with 250 people from, I think in the end, it was 33 or 34 different countries. It was really an amazing feat. I was leading all of this, but if you had asked me at the time, I would have said, well, I'm just a small wheel in this big engine. I'm just helping people. I'm not leading. I didn't associate with the term leader at all. And then different things happened, and I'll show you again in this moment. So how do I feel the system? How does the system feel me? I am not a leader. That was definitely no. That was not part of my identity. What I knew was the experience of running forward in terms of ideas, or in terms of progress, or in terms of I'm doing this, where are you? So that's the experience I was familiar with, but I didn't perceive that as leadership. I was also, there was this thing called TEAL, and I was very skeptical about it. I didn't have a proper be the leader. This whole idea with Agile is the thing people should go for, of telling people like this is the thing that you should go for, this was also alien to me, so this didn't really work. And as I said, role models for leaders, I always perceive the prominent model for leadership, I perceive that as stupid and not for me, and I didn't relate to that. So I didn't have anything to develop towards. I didn't have an idea of what that was. How do I serve the system? I actually helped a lot of people grow. And by being who I am and being how I am, I also helped create communities, I helped shape diversity into something useful. One of the things that happened that kind of gave me the confidence to see myself as a leader was a thing that we started in 2015, which we called the Leadership Academy. So I did start to trust myself in developing leaders, helping people become better leaders, because that's what I had been doing as a coach and consultant for years, but I still didn't conceive myself as a leader. What then happened was that people gave me feedback for my leadership over a period of many months. This was a 10-month program. And when you run a 10-month program and every week you do a check-in, people give you feedback. People tell you how you're leading. At some point you can't evade anymore. At some point I needed to accept it. Okay, obviously I'm leading something, and I need to integrate this idea that I'm actually a leader. So I told you about this Ale experience. I also at some point remembered that as a teenager I had been a scout leader, which in hindsight was quite a good experience of learning leadership with kids. But I had totally forgotten that. That was part of my, I don't know the word for that in English. When you don't want to remember a thing in the past, your head kind of shuts it off. There's a word for that in psychology. I don't know.
Dejo.
Dejo.
Probably.
This was the most recent change in terms of getting from programmer to leader, or agile leader, and integrating that, accepting that as a role, and putting that into perspective. This is the basic thing in our leadership course. It's a steering wheel. And the idea is that, as I said in the beginning, identity and intention is where it all starts. I need to know who I am, and I need to know what I want. Then I can make a difference. Remember when I said at the beginning, leadership to me is making a difference with intention. I could, I don't know, run through the room and create a path of broken chairs by accident. You could call it leadership, but it's not leadership I can improve because I didn't have any intention. So the intention is needed for the improvement. And then when I have this basis, I can turn my attention. And the attention goes mostly to developing relationships. For instance, I'm currently developing your relationship with this wheel. I'm also, and I have been for about 40 minutes, developing your relationship with me, but that's not so important. Developing the relationship between you and this wheel, this idea of the leadership wheel. Other things that I do as a leader, when I turn the wheel to this thing, focus on managing context. That means that we have chairs here, I have my laptop prepared, it still has some power to go with, yeah, it should be enough for the next 15 minutes. I have prepared the slides, I've created this drawing. This is context management, setting up the stuff that's needed for the relationship to develop, for something to happen, and for something to grow. Usually leadership means not only developing a relationship, but it means developing a relationship with something should grow. Like it could be a product, it could be your courage when I'm coaching you, it could be your confidence or your intention. It could be our team, it could be our organization. Depending on what kind of leadership I have, something is supposed to grow. And I need a solid understanding of this. So this is kind of the thing in the moment. This is one step back, setting up the context. This is two steps back. What do I understand about people at a conference learning something? How do I set up this drawing? How do I set up my talk so that you can pay attention and learn something? That's the background so that I can nurture this specific growth. And that's our understanding of leadership, and that's the summary of what we do nowadays. We run these leadership trainings. One thing I want to leave you with is something I learned about people. Sometimes I get asked, how can you be a trust artist? Some people can't be trusted. And then I always say, what, you can trust every single human being that they have the capacity to surprise you. Maybe by not doing what you feel they would do. Expectations are key to this. If you let go of your expectations, you have a lot more trust and you have a lot more opportunity for growth. Be the change you want to see. And I'm curious for your questions. I think I'm running out of slides. If you want to read something about this, there are two books, but they are being part. But that's this is a nice slide to stay with. Questions? Is there anything you'd like to know to go into details about?
Maybe for the questions, we can do a quick feedback round.
Sure.
Okay. To also a short exercise. Can everybody please stand up?
you notice too that people got tired?
It was a little late.
Yeah, it's late. We've been sitting all day. That's a really good idea.
So there are three levels of the feedback. For those who was thinking this talk was average, they can sit down. Thank you. For those who are thinking this is a good talk, they stay. And for those who are thinking that this was something exciting, those are doing like that. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Cool. Thank you.
A short exercise, and now we can go to the questions. So please. Yep.
So you said you have moved from a technical background to the agile.
Yeah.
So, how would you have adapted to this? How in your mindset, to the way of working, how do you have adapted?
Well, that's a very big question, because it's what I've shown you basically is in multiple steps, a method that I use for identifying necessary change. When you ask about the how do you actually adapt, usually by breathing, accepting that it hurts, noticing that when it hurts, that might mean that I'm learning something, and then trying to figure out what that is. So one thing as a pattern, something happens, I get hurt, and I get angry, and I get whatever, and then noticing, okay, this is not helpful, this is not changing anything. And also, like, being angry and pissing people off is not how I want to behave. So, next step, breathing, looking at, okay, what hurts, what can hurt, what is it? Is it a boundary being crossed, or do I need to let go of something? Do I need to understand something better? What is it actually that I need to learn here? And then, basically accepting it. Is that an answer to your question?
So, if I understand, you had to do a lot of learning before starting this and experiencing a lot of things before you change.
Yes, I'm struggling with the word before. So, I think there's learning and change, and these go hand in hand. The understanding, the head usually comes last. My experience is that there's something that changes, something I change, and then I understand, oh, this is what happened, right? That's also how this talk makes sense. This method is usually used to look at something right now, but understanding my choices that I made 20 years ago, 10 years ago, 5 years ago, with this lens, was helpful for me to understand, okay, how did that actually work? How did that happen?
One more question. What was the support from the already existing Agile community? Like one technical guy came into the coaching and you started coaching. So how was the
That's a topic for another 45 minutes. But briefly, lots of good feedback. Good feedback in the sense of, hey, this is good, do more of it, and stop doing this, it's not helping. Simple friendship, noticing that other people struggle in the same way, being able to share stories, being able to share failures and successes, and just feeling part of a tribe instead of feeling like I'm fighting against windmills on my own. I think those are probably the two most important kinds of support from the community. Not feeling alone and getting feedback.
Well, thank you.
Good questions.
Thank you. We have time for one more. Okay.
Hi, so since from a technical guy you became an agile coach, I would like to have your opinion on Scrum Masters. So in one of the previous sessions, we were told that Scrum Master doesn't necessarily have to come from IT background. Mm-hmm. So how do you think, is it beneficial to have someone who was a developer before and then transition to Scrum Master, or it's not like necessary?
I do agree it's not necessary. It can be helpful and it can also be limiting. So as a developer, I have a development and an engineering perspective that is sometimes very helpful, but it can also be limiting. I see the world very similarly to the people on my team. If you have one team and only one choice of what kind of Scrum Master you choose, I would say it doesn't matter. Because the Scrum Master learns with the team, and any Scrum Master, developer Scrum Master or non-developer Scrum Master, will give meaningful help to the team and learn with the team to figure out what do we do next. The learning paths will be different. When you have multiple teams and multiple Scrum Masters in the organizations, do both. And have some Scrum Masters who are really, really good developers, as part of their Scrum Mastering, can do technical mentoring to the teams. So they would go around and help all the teams learn TDD and pair programming and continuous integration, all these good technical practices. And you will have other Scrum Masters who are probably better at the personal side of things, at the coaching side of Scrum Mastering, at the developing team cohesion and these things. And then they can help more teams doing that, so that you have more of a Scrum Master community serving a larger group of teams, and rather than have every Scrum Master just focusing on their whole team and nothing else. That's about my sense of this.
Thank you. Okay.
Thank you for the presentation. You mentioned that when you started to be a boss, you worked from 10 a.m. from 10 a.m. until the morning, 2 a.m.
Yeah.
Can you share what was your schedule through all your career steps? When you was a reader and you become a programmer until now?
Well, I can share a few highlights of what I remember. As a developer, there were definitely some program through nights. That was something that occasionally happened. Thank God, not very often. But usually the developing was a 40-hour job, sometimes 50 hours, in the first company where I worked full-time. This combination of being a programmer and a boss was really, really unhealthy. Because the pattern that kind of evolved, because I didn't know how to do meetings. I had no experience in doing meetings. I was pulled into this company, I was pulled into this boss position, and suddenly I had all these meetings in my calendar, and I needed to attend all of them, apparently. And I still wanted to do all the programming, and I also had a team of people who needed my leadership in terms of architecture, programming, etc. So I ended up by accident. It was obviously not my wish, by spending my day in meetings and then spending my night programming. Definitely not something I would recommend to anyone. And then as a consultant, I had a lot of years where I would spend my day at the client with whatever work was there, and then evening in a hotel, either sending, answering emails, doing still some occasional programming for the stuff that I was helping the clients with, preparing slides for conferences and stuff. So that was also long work weeks. Now as I'm independent, it's healthier. There are still periods. My wife is not in the room. She would probably say differently, but there are still periods where I work a lot and where I spend odd hours answering emails or having phone calls or stuff like that. So there are also days where I don't do a lot of work at all because I can set my own schedule. So it's become a lot healthier in recent years, but that's not been for very long. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. So let's give applause for all of you.